JJ, and I'm here to talk to you about GDPR. So does anyone know what GDPR is? Yes, hand at the back. GDPR is the new General Data Protection Regulation, and it is an EU directive, so don't all fall asleep now. It's due to come into force May the 25th, 2018. So we've got some time to prepare for it. With GDPR being an EU directive, the obvious question is what happens about Brexit? And the first time I gave this talk, we didn't have an answer. Now we actually do, courtesy of Secretary of State Karen Bradley MP. So she announced, I believe last month, that we will be opting into GDPR because it will take effect before we actually leave the EU. So it will then be a choice whether to keep that afterwards or make changes. But what actually is it? Now, fundamentally, the GDPR is a set of regulations designed to change the way that we think about data, specifically people's personal data. And it's all based on one key principle. And that key principle is that my personal data, if I'm submitting that to your company, your website, it's a loan, not a gift. And taking that principle on board, treating everybody's data as if they have lent it to you, is a great way to actually comply with the regulations. So what does that actually mean, though? So if you think about any sort of loan, could be, you know, I'll lend you my lawnmower or something like that. I expect you to do various things. So number one, ask me before borrowing it. Don't just take it. If I ask you to give it back to me, then return it. I might say that actually I don't want that thing I lent you anymore. Can you throw it away? I also expect you to tell me if you lost it. So yeah, talk about the data breaches and things like that. I would also like to remind me how you got it. What if I lent it to you while I was drunk? So those are the key principles within the GDPR regulation.
In the field of software development, red light's gone. So in software development, what we're talking about now is privacy by design. So to be compliant with the regulations, we need to see that privacy has been built in throughout your application stack. So going back to those principles about treating personal data as a loan rather than a gift. So and starting off with, I want you to ask me before borrowing it. This is talking about consent. So if you want to use my personal information, sign me up to a mailing list or any kind of data processing, I have to give you consent. And it's defined in the regulations that I have to give clear affirmative action. So it has to be affirmative, it has to be a conscious step that I'm saying yes, as opposed to I'm unticking the checkbox and saying no. And that consent has to be freely given, and I can refuse it without detriment. So you can't say that you're going to give me a lower quality of service if I refuse to give you consent to use my personal data. You can't say that you're not going to deal with me as a customer if I refuse to give that consent. And it must also, if I have given you that consent, be easy to revoke. And it actually says in the regulations, it alludes to the mechanism for revoking consent needs to be essentially the same as the mechanism for giving consent. So if I've signed up by ticking the checkbox, I should be able to sign out by doing the same kind of operation. If I've got to say, you know, tick a checkbox to sign up for your mailing list, but you're say
subscribe, send a fax, we'll fax you back, sign it, put it in the post. That's a no-no, it's got to be just as easy. So if you've got things like pre-tick checkboxes on your sites at the moment, that's, in the new world, a bit of a no-no. Second thing is reminding how you got consent. So I'm sure we've all had the experience of, you know, you suddenly get random emails from a company on a mailing list, and you think, well, I don't remember signing up to that. How have I actually got my details? Did I forget to tick the checkbox, or have they bought my data in from somebody else? So the regulations now say that you have to prove that you had consent. And being able to prove that you had consent is a lot more than a simple Boolean field in your database to say, is somebody a member or not? So that's got to go. Instead, we're going to need to actually store metadata. So things like a timestamp. When did I sign up for this thing? What was the source of the data? So maybe that's an IP address, or maybe that's an indication that that you know you had that data transferred in from a third party. And just on the topic of IP addresses, it is interesting to note that an IP address is specifically defined as personal data. So huge implications for logging, things like that. If you've got somebody's IP, that can trace back to an individual through records that internet service providers are now legally obliged to keep for a long period of time. So you need to be just as careful about processing your log files as your actual customer database. The next part of the loan is what happens when that's the loan of the personal data might end. So I'm going to say, give it back to me. Data portability is how they actually describe this in the regulations. Now at the moment we have a form of this in the current Data Protection Act, in that you can request from any organisation that holds information about you, you can request a copy of that information so you can check its accuracy and so on. And organisations currently can charge a fee of £10 for doing so. So it's interesting, if you ever need to do something like get a copy of old bank statements or something like that, and your banks normally charge like £2.50, £3 a page for reprints of old statements, don't bother doing that. Just ask them for a copy of everything they have on you. The maximum, the only fee they can charge is £10, and they have to give you everything. So, but the sort of thing that you get at the moment is maybe a screen print in the post, or prints of microfiche, or something like that. What's very interesting in the GDPR is now that's not good enough. It's now specified that returning data to somebody has to be machine readable. And not just machine readable, but actually usable for an import. Because the aim of data portability is that you as a consumer of a service should be able to go to a competitor and take data with you. So it has to be portable. So usable for somebody else to do an import. And that in turn means it has to be structured, it has to be in a common format. That common format has to have a well-known schema, and essentially it be an open standard. So if you do an interchange format and that is just something that's proprietary and undocumented, that's not going to cut it. Need to use open standards. Obviously this is great for open source. You can't just send somebody a binary blob. We're talking, XML, JSON, CSV, but something with a published schema so that somebody else can make sense.
somewhat tied in with data portability is actually the right to, is called right to erasure. And it's used in earlier versions of the regulations, they call it the right to deletion. But it's not technically deletion, it's erasure is a little bit different. Don't necessarily mean that kind of erasure. But yeah, I'm going to be gratuitous with pictures about that one as well. So what we're saying with the right to erasure is that the loan of my personal data to you has finished. I don't want it back, but I don't want you as the organisation to have it anymore. So just delete it. Now this has big implications for lots, you know, for everybody, but particularly things like e-commerce. If you were, you know, if you were Amazon or anybody, and a customer says to you, right, I don't want to be your customer anymore, you've got to delete everything you have on me. And so with the erasure, it doesn't mean that you have to just do this. It's not about deletion, because obviously if you were deleting things, that would conflict with other regulations like financial regulations, where you have to keep transactions for certain periods of time for audit purposes. And of course, it only applies to the personal data aspect, not the transactional data. So instead of really being a deletion, this is more about doing anonymization, tokenization. So you need to have some kind of a function on your customer object that can say, erase the personal data of this customer, but keep everything else. So we need to still know, yes, you know, X units of this product were sold on this date, and all the financial side of things. So part of your database schema, you're going to need to know which fields in your database are actually personal, which are the ones that you need to erase. What we can then do is tokenization. So replace that information with data that is essentially random or dummy. And the point really is to make sure that that you can't undo. So replacing something with, for example, just an MD5 hash of the input probably wouldn't be compliant, because somebody who has an idea what the source data could do can then attack it and verify that. So you need to think a bit more carefully about how you would actually implement such a anonymization function. So, you know, bring in other factors such as identifiers to say that actually I'm going to wipe out this company, this customer record, but I'm going to replace them. So a lot of work to do, you know, generally in the industry to achieve this. So lots of system changes to support erasure, to support the data portability, and so on. Now imagine if you've already got a customer database, but you've only got a Boolean field to say yes, people have opted in. You're going to have to go and re-request consent, go and ask people again to confirm that they are, you know, freely giving you that consent. So you can expect to receive a lot of emails saying, please confirm you want to subscribe to this mailing list, or you will be unsubscribed, which is, you know, quite good for getting spam. Now, although there's going to be a lot of development work for people to do generally, I would see the impact of this regulation as being something that is very, very positive. Certainly positive for us in our roles as consumers and rather than necessarily developers. Because the concept of making privacy the default, in my view, could only be a good thing. Particularly portability with standards, been able to just automatically download information that I've stored in the cloud or have with other service providers. It means I can do my own backups, things like that. So, central thing to remember with this, data is a loan, not a gift. If you treat it as such, then you'll be all right. So, thank you very much for listening. Any questions? Yeah.
What happens if a company have got an offsite backup from 3 months ago or a year ago or something, and a customer requests their data to be deleted? Does that backup have to be kind of thrown away or redone? What happens?
That is one of the, so the question was, if you've got a if you have backup like stored offsite, customer requests that you delete their information, do you have to go and delete your backup? That's, I think, a very interesting question that I don't believe anyone actually has a definitive answer for yet. Assuming that your backups are rotated, so that you're not keeping it permanently, you're doing a sort of you might be doing weeklies and keep the last 4 weeks, something like that, then because you have the intention of deleting it, and it will happen, I'd be pretty sure that that would be
a grace period, so.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was about to say, but presumably if you're doing that, if you re-imported the backup, you'd have to make sure you re-ran the raising the custom data.
Yes,
that procedure in place for that.
Is where it would become. Yes, if you did a restore from the backup. So you're kind of going to want to have some sort of a journal going on of the deletion requests that you've received, so you can rerun them, and then make sure you back that up. But then don't back it up because you're not allowed to store it.
Does it apply to B2B transactions as well, business to business? So we talk about consumers.
Yeah. No. This is about consumer personal data rather than business data is different.
Does it say anything explicit though about, that was my question, though, about B2B model where, so a company has essentially got its employees to opt into them, you're providing a service to the company, so you're data controller, data processor, not controller.
Mm-hmm.
Does it say anything about your rights to the end user, i.e. their employees, or does it still keep it all on their employer?
So, just so I understand that, so you as a company store data about your employees, and you as a company get somebody else to process that?
So, to say my company is providing a service to another company, and we're storing personal data about their employees, but our contract is with the company to carry the data, and under the Data Protection Act, it's the company's responsibility. The other company's responsibility to manage it and to make sure that we are managing it. I'm just wondering, is that scenario explicitly covered in the GDPR?
I believe it is. There are a number of exemptions for scenarios where it kind of wouldn't make sense for people to have the ability to opt out. So things like HR function in a business. If you as an employee had a disciplinary or something like that, you're not going to be able to go and then say to your HR manager, I want you to delete all my personal data and erase me and forget about that disciplinary hearing. Those kind of things are covered. Information that's retained for law enforcement purposes, for example, as well. Yes, I'd like you to erase me from the DNA database. Not going to work.
You mentioned IPs being personal data.
Yeah.
How does that fit in with government requirements and so on keeping logging and stuff? For example, in ISPs and things that are going to keep data, you can ask to remove that.
Consistency. I think it would fall into the law enforcement exemptions because it's that's why they're keeping the data ostensibly.
We most of the parts will record your IP without before you ask permission. And you just take a log pass full of your IP address. So
yeah.
Kind of stuff, huh?
Pretty much. Yeah. It's like there's a When we did this talk at Little Keynes Pearl Mongers, an interesting scenario was pointed out. So you have me on your mailing list, and I say, I want you to take me off your list and never send me anything again. And the only response you can give is, well, I can do one or the other, not both. If I say I'm going to record a flag to say I never send you anything again, in order to do that, I have to retain your personal details. I have to know that your email address is on my don't send list. If I forget about you, then that doesn't stop anybody else subscribing to this list with your email address or you subscribing, and I will send you something again because I forgot that I ever had this conversation.
But wouldn't that require confirmation?
It would, yes.